summary, as you know, Louise is away, and her passport care is listed in the bulletin what to do with that. And just wanted to say thank you again to Jenny Wilson and Gene Tucker for putting on the food truck event that went so well. It was a really nice community event, so thank you very much. And we hope to experience that again soon. And also, the backpack project is winding up, and there's a bunch of them downstairs, as you can see, so thank you for contributing. And there is still a little bit of time if you want to do a backpack, or 10, or 20, or however many you want to do. You could do them and get them in next Sunday, or an exercise class would still be in time as well. So, are there any birthdays or anniversaries right now?
Thank you.
cast out of Eden, enslaved in Egypt, exiled to Babylon. Please help us find our way back to you, so that we may realize we are never truly apart. Amen. An invitation to confession. Dear God, please forgive us for the many ways we stray off the path. Forgive us for being distracted by all the pleasures and troubles of this world. A lot of the time, we know not what we do. And Jesus teaches us that God seeks out the solitary lost sheep and coin, and welcomes back all the prodigal sons and daughters with open arms and celebration. So be not afraid. Now we sing, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore You, Voices United 232.
For the kingdom of God belongs to those who are like these children.
I tell you the truth. Anyone who doesn't receive the kingdom of God like a child will never enter it. And on that note, any children, you actually don't have to. I can do the same thing here. So just going to tell a story that I find very interesting about children. Hopefully the children will find it interesting too, and hopefully they can relate to it better than anybody. Anyway, there's a story about a family, a young family, parents and daughters, 3 years old, and they have another baby born, and they're bringing the baby home from the hospital, and the three-year-old daughter makes a special request to her parents. She says, I would really like to just be alone with the baby and just be able to talk to the baby on my own. And the parents think that's a bit strange at first, but they got one of those crib monitors in the room, so you know, if something crazy is going to happen, they're going to know about it. So they say, sure, you can do that. So this comes about, and the parents are listening on the monitor, and they hear the daughter going up to the crib, to the baby, and they hear her say, "Tell me about God. I've almost forgotten." And that's it. So that story is about losing something through forgetting. And in this case, it's you're losing something really big. You're losing your oneness with God, your connection with God. And I used to, when I first heard this story, I used to be really sorry for the girl. The poor girl, that's awful. And I still am sorry for her. But then I realized that the same thing happened to all of us as well. So there's a lot more people to feel sorry for. The difference with us now, with those of us who are adults, or even older children, is that we most likely don't even remember that we lost something. And losing things, of course, is very aggravating. There's just something about it. You know, you had something, and you knew where it was, and now where is it? You just can't find it. But there's different varieties of losing things, and I think one of the worst ones is maybe losing something and then forgetting that you ever had it in the first place. Although it doesn't necessarily have to be the worst thing. You might say that that's a blessing in disguise because you can't miss something if you've forgotten all about it. So it's kind of like a victimless crime. But what if it's something really important that you've lost? That's a bit unnerving. What could I have lost? What if I forgot that I buried $1 million in my backyard? What if I forgot that I'm actually heir to the throne of Sweden? What if I forgot that I can fly? What if I forgot that I'm one with God? And what if you are suffering because of what you lost? And you don't realize it because now it's normal. It's been going on for so long. Suffering seems to be a major part of human existence. And most of it is caused by fear and anger and hatred, all of which result from being cut off from God. We forget that the most important part of who we are is divine and eternal, and so the death of our earthly body becomes something to be afraid of, and we live our lives in a cloud of fear. Instead of remembering that we are one with the entire cosmos, we believe ourselves to be separate individuals who struggle against a cruel world that often blocks us from getting what we want, and this makes us angry. We no longer realize that every person, every creature you meet, is part of the same vast union of life. And so we often see others as obstacles, competitors, and even enemies who we hate. What can be done about all this? When you've forgotten what you've lost, is there any solution? how do you even know that you've lost something? Well, you might feel the loss deep in your heart. Many people feel that something is missing in their life, that there's a void that needs filling. Unfortunately, we get all kinds of wrong ideas about what's missing, and we try to fill the void with them. Money, food, possessions, achievements. If you're lucky, someone might tell you what you've lost. Hey John, what are you doing here? Aren't you supposed to be the king of Norway? Ruth, why are you trudging along on your feet when you can fly? But who will let us know that we've lost our oneness with God when everyone else seems to be in the same boat? It really is the blind leading the blind. And even if someone does tell you this, how will you ever find it again? You may already believe in your mind that you were one with God, and so you know one of the great secrets of life. We are all divine, all expressions of God. And believing that is a wonderful thing, but it's just the beginning. The mental concept of oneness with God is not the same as experiencing it firsthand. You might think that you'd enjoy skydiving, but you won't actually know until you try. And imagine the difference between just thinking about skydiving and actually doing it. I'm not going to try skydiving, but feel free if you want. So how do we go beyond mental concepts about God and get back to the first-hand experience we used to have? How do we rediscover what we've lost? Well, Christianity holds the keys, as do most other religions. In fact, it's possible that the original meaning of the word religion was to relink or reconnect, which perfectly describes what needs to happen between us and God. There's a slight problem, though. The Christian religion that most people are familiar with is descended from what you might call the entry-level version, and it's mostly been stuck there for millennia. Most Christians aren't even aware that their religion has a deeper level that teaches us how to reconnect to God. It's almost being forgotten, just like the little girl said. You're probably wondering what happens with it. Well, to go back to the theme of losing something, how many of you have ever intentionally hidden something and then forgotten all about it, or forgot where you did it? Well, I suspect I've done this, but I'm not really sure. And don't squirrels do this? I think I've heard that somewhere. But that's basically what happened to Christianity. The deeper teachings were intentionally hidden because they don't usually make sense unless you work your way into them gradually, starting at the entry level. But it seems that Christianity fell prey to the same human hunger for power that leads some people to keep others in the dark in order to control them. Only about a century after Jesus' time, a Christian leader named Origen was complaining that other Christian leaders were no longer teaching the deeper meanings of the scriptures. And this was well before Christianity became the state religion of the Roman Empire and was forced upon people, and Jesus became a god to be worshipped rather than a guide to be followed. But luckily, the deeper teachings have survived in many Christian monasteries, and now books and the internet are helping to make them available to anyone with ears to listen. So what are these deeper teachings? Jesus points right at it in Luke when he says, "The kingdom of God is within you." So basically, it's about looking deep within yourself to find God, using meditation or contemplation or prayer. This will put you back in touch with the divine reality that's always been there, but became hidden by all the mental programming we've absorbed since early childhood. As Jesus says in Mark, the kingdom of God belongs to those who are like these children. He didn't say the kingdom of God belongs to these children. He said those who are like these children. So it's not just children that the kingdom belongs to. It's telling us that we need to act not like babies, but we need to learn to break free from the prison that has been built in our minds. And if we can do that, we'll regain a way of experiencing life that we lost as children. And then we can re-enter the kingdom. The Bible is loaded with wisdom and guidance of this sort. And it would take years to go through it all. So for now, I'll just highlight a few examples for you. In general terms, many of the Bible's most powerful stories are referring to what happened to us as young children. You can take them literally as well, that's fine, but there's also a deeper meaning to them. We were exiled from the Garden of Eden, enslaved by Pharaoh in Egypt, held captives in Babylon, and we strayed from home like the prodigal son. And all of these I can describe very nicely losing God as a child. Now, a more detailed example of some good guidance for us is in the story of Noah's Ark. And once again, you're welcome to take it literally. Maybe it something like that did happen at some point. But there are also some very clear signs that the way it was written was intended to teach us something else at the same time. And some of the early Christians actually pointed out that the scriptures will often contain things that will strike you as unlikely, impossible, just maybe wrong. And I think if you look at Noah's Ark in a certain way, that it will strike you that way. And those are supposed to be signs to send you looking deeper. You'll say, well, this doesn't make sense to me on the surface. So what is the real meaning? Or what's the deeper meaning here that's been included? So with Noah's Ark, as with many other stories, there are often clues in the meaning of the names that are of the characters. So one translation from Hebrew of the name Noah is rest, especially the idea of coming to rest after a period of turmoil. And it's no coincidence that that's what happens in the story of Noah's Ark. Noah is the one who has the ark that comes to rest after the terrible flood, comes to rest on a high place. And so coming to rest is just another term for the idea of coming to rest within yourself, stilling your mind and yourself, and overcoming the turmoil that might be raging inside your mind at whatever time. And floods are often depicted that way, or used that way to represent mental turmoil. Jesus does a similar thing when he calms the storm. It's a parallel to Noah's Ark. And the ark, an ark was never really a term to use for a boat. If it's a container, like the Ark of the Covenant, it's a holy container. And what Noah did was he was able to find a safe place for himself, within himself, that would help him to rise above all the turmoil. So that's one possible interpretation of Noah's Ark. There are lots of other ones as well. And I can't use these things to give you absolute proof of anything, using words and quotes as evidence. Although I'm sure some of you are instinctively recognizing the truth as you hear it. But as Paul said to the Corinthians, my speech and my preaching were not in persuasive words of wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power. Proof is to be found in the experience, by following the path laid out by Jesus and finding out for yourself what infants are born knowing. As St. Julian of Norwich put it, we are made of God. This is the truth, the life, the good news, and the path of return to God is the way. Now, if you like, you can try using a simple piece of practical advice from Jesus. You're probably familiar with him advising us to be like a servant waiting for their master to return from a wedding feast. And, you know, there's a literal level to that, but there's also a level where this is giving us some advice on how to still our minds and reconnect with God. So if you want to try it with me now, then you're free. It's very simple. Just pretend with me you are all servants awaiting the return of your master. Since you don't know exactly when the master will return from the wedding, you must be completely ready, giving your full attention to listening for the master's approach. So try to do that now. It could happen at any moment, so you have to stay completely alert. Do you hear their footsteps on the stairs, or maybe on the road outside? Listen very carefully and be very still. And while you're at full attention, try to be aware of what this feels like, what it's like to be fully attentive in the moment. And take that feeling, and if you can, go deeper into it for a minute of silence. Something there, perhaps a peaceful stillness, but don't worry if you didn't. This technique doesn't necessarily work for everyone, and there are many other ways of doing that. You've probably already had many brief experiences of the divine in your own life, enjoying the beauty of nature, music, love. Or perhaps you're someone who can completely lose themselves while they work at simple tasks. All of these have the potential to bring you deeper into the present moment where God's presence can be more strongly felt. Unfortunately, these experiences are mostly short-lived because they get blocked by the endless chatter of the mind, which is the Pharaoh who enslaves us by asking things like, shouldn't you be doing something more useful, like making money or worrying about your fears for the future? Pharaoh is very powerful, but as the Bible teaches us, he can be overcome by persistence. I originally offered to speak today because the worship committee was looking for people to give testimony, and I wanted to share some of the spiritual quest I've been on for the last few years. I'm only yet a novice starting out on the Christian path of return to God, but I've already been blessed with an incredible amount of peace and sometimes joy. In the 3 years that I've been practicing Christian contemplation, I've only been sick once, where before I used to catch every passing cold and must have been sick 10 times a year. So it's been a huge boost to my immune system. I don't need as much sleep as I used to either. From the testimony I've heard and read from others who have gone further down this path, I know that what I've experienced is just the tip of the iceberg. If you're interested in exploring this path, I strongly encourage you to do so. Pharaoh will try to keep a grip on you and will try to talk you out of it because that's the end of Pharaoh once you've gone far enough. But if you would like any advice, please speak to me, or phone me, or email me, or come to Spiritual Explorations the last Tuesday of every month, or Silence and Stillness on Monday nights. Or you could just follow a simple piece of divine advice found in Psalm 46. Be still and know that I am God. If you have any questions or comments, you're quite welcome to make them now or after the service, whatever you like. So we're going to sing Amazing Grace, which is Voices United 266.
Thank you.
just point out, in case anybody's not so familiar, that when you give your offering, the one half of the envelope is for the mission and service fund, which supports these sorts of things. And even more so now, the United Church has just, at the latest conference, approved restructuring that will allow more of the money given to mission service to go towards these sorts of things, rather than to some of the more structural things in the United Church. The offering will now be received.
Thank you.
pregnant, will now sing, God be with you till we meet again. Voices United 422.
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah.
That's too late.
Yeah. Because, you know, I figured out that comment.
So you're broadcasted out here.